Rise up to pray together. Our Father, we thank you very much for this day. Thank you for what you have taught us from the beginning of this day. We thank you, Lord, for your power. Thank you, Lord, for your word. And we thank you for the inspiration of your word and the revelation you are giving unto us. Lord, we pray that you will guide the one of Jesus. And we pray, Lord, the revelation of God will make all members of the church to become extra ordinances in Jesus' name. The power of the Holy Ghost, the real power, the anointing that will appear for your own people, every one of us tonight, in Jesus' name. Show us the way, show us your word, and show us your will. That, Lord, as we get into your word, grace will be your power, the anointing, flowing into our lives, in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray, Lord, that your word will enlighten us. Your word will empower us. Your word will make us to be who we ought to be. In the name of the Lord, in Jesus' name. You've given us a commission, you've given us a commandment, and you've given us the consecration. Oh Lord, we pray, everything we need to be able to accomplish, everything you've given us to do, we're going to accomplish in the name of Jesus. Help us, Lord, to have real understanding of your word. And according to the real understanding of your word, we're going to march on like a mighty army. Nothing will defeat us in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray that tonight you lay your hands upon us. And we pray, Lord, real experience of your word you grant to every one of us, that we will be mighty army, irresistible army, conquering army, prevailing army, in the name of the Lord, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have done. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And the people of God said, amen. Thank you very much. You can see on tonight, we're looking at the word of God. Ordinary church members with extraordinary ministries. Ordinary church members, that is the people, they are born again, the children of God, they appear ordinary, no title, no position, but then they have the power of God and the Spirit of God in their lives, and then they begin to do extraordinary things, and they do exploits for the name of the Lord and for the evangelization of their community. As you look at the New Testament, that's the kind of church you find. Ordinary, yes, a membership, yes, but then they have this extraordinary anointing and power. And I can show you the word, it's not just the apostles, it's not just the people that have offices or titles. In the New Testament, the people that are just disciples, they say, a certain disciple, ordinary people that just went out, they scattered everywhere, and he did exploits for the Lord. And I pray that this, that same anointing will come upon us. That same power will come upon us. That same illumination of the world, revelation of the world will come upon our lives. And we're going to do great things for the Lord in Jesus' name. We're looking at the Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, I'm reading to you from verse 41. Why don't we start from verse 40? It says, with many other words, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word, they were baptized, and it says the same day they were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. And it says, and fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles and all that believed. They were together, and then it says that they had all things common, and sold their possessions and their goods, and parted them to all men, as every man had need. And it says, and they continued daily with one accord in the temple, and in breaking of bread from house to house, they did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. You can see there the word church. Actually, Jesus Christ mentioned that word for the first time when he said, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Many people don't have understanding what the church is all about. They say, I'm going to the church. They mean that they're going to a building, they're going to a sanctuary, they're going to a temple. And when they're going to a building, they say, I'm going to church. But you know what Jesus said? He said, if your brother offends you, Tell him, you yourself alone, by him. If he does not hear, tell another person, so that out of the two or the mouth of two or three witnesses, the truth shall be established. Then you said, if he does not hear them, those other people, tell the church. That means it's not a church, merely tell the church. If he does not hear the church, that means the membership of the church, the people in the church. The church is an assembly of people. The church is a congregation. It's a congregation of converted people, saved people, transformed people. The people who have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and their lives have changed. That is the church. Can I show you the church here? It says the Lord added. Added to what? Added to what? Added to the church. What's the church? Who are the people that the Lord was adding to them, adding to them, adding? Number one, they were saved people. Look at verse 41. It says, then they that gladly received his word were baptized. Do you remember what he said? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. These people were saved. Number two, they were separated. Separated from the world, all the degradation, the defilement, all those evil things from the world, they were separated. Look at verse 40. And with many other words, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourself from this untoward generation. Therefore, we learn that the church is a people who are saved, a people who are separated. Not only that, they were steadfast. They were steadfast. They were not people that are crawling in and crawling out. They came to the Lord and abode in the Lord. They came to the Lord and remained in the Lord. They were disciples, full-time disciples. They were people that believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and consistently they were steadfast in the Lord. Why don't you look at verse 42? It says, and they continued. What's the next word there? Steadfastly. They were steadfast. You know, some of these people, they come to crusades and then they raise up their hands and then you follow up on them and they cannot even come. There is no genuine experience of salvation for the church of the New Testament. And the church we're talking about, that we have ordinary church members with extraordinary ministries, extraordinary power, extraordinary exploits. Number one, saved. Number two, they were separated. Number three, they were steadfast. But you know, they were submissive. Look at verse 43. And it says, and fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. They were submissive to the apostles. If the apostles said up, they went up. If the apostles said stay, they stayed. If the apostles said this and the teaching, the doctrine, they are bored by the word of God. They accepted the word of God. There are not people that are running here and there, uncontrollable people, incorrigible people. There are not people that were not hearing the word. They heard the word. They obeyed the word. They were submissive people. Saved, that's church. Separated, that's church. Steadfast, that's church. And submissive, that is church. It also tells us they were sanctified. Look at verse 44. In verse 44, and all that believed were together. Isn't that what the prayer Jesus prayed? Oh Lord, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And then he said that they all may be one, as thou Father art in me and I in you. The people who were sanctified, that their unity was there in the church. No big I and little you. They were having all things common. These people, that's what we call the church. As we look at our local churches, can we say they are saved? As we look at our local churches, can we say they are separated? As we look at our local churches, can we say they are steadfast? As we look at our local churches, can we say they are submissive? As we look at our local churches, can we say they are sanctified? The church of the New Testament and the church Jesus Christ raised up, and the church has called us to raise up, that the ordinary members of such a church, they did exploits in the name of the Lord. They were sanctified people. Look at that verse 44 again, and it says, and all that believe were together and had all things common. They were sharing church. They were sharing church. They shared what they had. They were not saying, this belongs to me. Selfishness was gone. Self-centeredness at God. They knew that their lives and their resources and their skills and their abilities, they made available unto everyone. They were a sharing church. Look at verse 45. It says, and they sold their possession and their goods, and they parted them to all men, as everyone arch need. That means it was sacrificial. It was sacrificial. It's not, well, that's not comfortable for me. That's not convenient for me. How can I have been laboring? I've been doing this and doing that. I know my sweat. Everything I put into it. And then I'm going to give that to so and so. And give that to so and so. If she is not from my tribe, and he is not from my locality, he doesn't speak the same dialect as I spoke. He never thought about anything like that. This church we're talking about, saved and separated. This church we're talking about, set apart and submissive. This church we're talking about, sanctified and sacrificial. This church we're talking about, sharing, is shared with everybody. And this is the kind of church the Lord is telling us to resolve. It is not a church where you have that language group and that language group and that other language group and this tribe and that other tribe, and they're fighting one another. And if you put maybe somebody from the north, you put a state overseer in the south, how can that be? How can this man be an overseer? If you put someone from southwest and you put him in the southeast, how can that be? It's not, it doesn't have a language. It doesn't speak this one, doesn't speak that one. If you put somebody from southeast and put him in south, everybody say, why? Don't we have that one man? Who is your man? Who's your man? Everyone, they were sharing together. All the selfishness was gone. Don't you know the Jewish people? The Jewish people naturally, traditionally, they look down on other people. They even look down on the tribes. They'll say Benjamin, the smallest tribe. They'll say this Reuben, the one that did this. They had their histories and they had all their conflicts among them. But when they became born again, all that vanished away. All the tribalism vanished away. All the sexualism vanished away. All the tradition, everything vanished away. And thank God for a church like ours. I said thank God for a church like ours. That if a southeast person is leading us in south-south, no problem. If south-south is brought to southwest, no problem. And if southwest, southeast is gone to the north, there's no problem. And if the north comes to the south, there's no problem. Don't you see us in this retreat, in this congress over here, somebody is coming from that other place is preaching to us, and that one is coming from that other place preaching to us. And we just accept the word of God because they have the Spirit of God. All that sectionalism, all that tribalism, everything is totally gone. And that's what we find the people here, all the self-centeredness and the self-will, everything totally gone. Then what is sacrificial church? I want you to look at verse 46, that we see their single-mindedness. And it tells us in verse 46, and they continue daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread and from house to house, and they did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. They were single-minded. That's the church. That's the church. If you look at your church and look at the members we are talking about, that the ordinary members who are saved, ordinary members who are sanctified, ordinary members who are separated, ordinary members who are sharing, ordinary members who are sacrificial, ordinary members who are submissive, ordinary members who are so willing also, and all those members who are sacrificial and single-minded, that kind of church. The members there, ordinary members there, they will do extraordinary things. Look at verse 47 there, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church such as should be saved, because they were evangelizing, they were soul winning. And they want to have a picture of what the church ought to be. They want to have a picture of the people that the Lord said, I'm going to empower. The people that he says, I'm going to energize. And I'm going to put my spirit, my strength, my power, my might in their lives, so that those ordinary members of such a New Testament church, they will do exploits. I pray that it will happen to you in Jesus' name. I said it will happen to you in Jesus' name. I'm looking at 3 points here. Number one, I'm looking at experiential godliness in ordinary church members. Experiential godliness in ordinary church members. That's why they were extraordinary. That's why they did extraordinary things, because the experience they had, it was not just a superficial make-believe. I'm sure you know that in those days, there were people that were superficial. There were people that were carnal, there were people that were fleshly, there were people that had head knowledge, head faith, there were people that didn't have something real. Let me just show you those counterfeits and those carnal people and those people that were not real. And you need to be able to discover and discern. that this one is real and that one is not real. When people pray, you ought to be able to say this one is real, this one is not real. When people stand up in your church and, yes, I have a question, and they ask a question, you ought to be able to know this one is a real neighbor, and this one is not real. You ought to be able to know when we come together like this, this one is real, this one is fake, this one is counterfeit. If you're not able to discover counterfeit money, you labor in vain. If you're not able to discover counterfeit as so-called believers, you will labor in vain. I'm showing you John chapter 2. In John chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 23. John chapter 2, verse 23. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover, in the feast day, many believed in his name. When they saw the miracles which he did, but Jesus did not commit himself unto them, because he knew all men, and needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. You see that? He committed himself to this one, not real. Those were counterfeits. Those are not my disciples. He said, we should be able to know that this one is real and that one is counterfeit. Look at 2 Timothy, in 2 Timothy chapter 3. I'm reading there from verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're looking at verse 7. So that you don't take everybody that says, Jesus, Jesus, Lord, Lord, Master, Master, deeper life, deeper life. You don't take everyone like that as a real believer, as a real Christian. They say that ordinary members will have extraordinary ministries, but I see that member. No extraordinary ministry. I see that one. But you must be able to discern that those who call themselves members, they are not real members. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, I'm looking at verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 7. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Ever learning. Ever learning, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. You can tell them, when we see members who are talking about members that have the word, and the word impacted their lives, and the word influenced their lives, and the word affected their lives. They're not the people that are ever learning, always coming, every program, every retreat, every conference, every congress, and it doesn't have any kind of transformation, any kind of work, any kind of thing in their lives. The same old tribalism they had before. All that tribalism is still there, and the same fighting they had in their blood, in their heart, before, that fighting is still there. The same gossip they had before, all that gossip is still there. The same covetousness, love of money that was there before, all that is still there. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Those are not the real believers. Titus chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 16. Titus chapter 1, verse 16 says, it profess, they confess and they profess and proclaim that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work reprobate. You know, it says the professor, they know him. When the testimony time comes, praise the Lord, I give my life to the Lord Jesus at this point. History. But there is nothing real today. There's no present experience. Those are the people that are counterfeit. Thank God I'm not a counterfeit. I say, thank God I'm not a counterfeit. Now the Lord is talking about the people that really came to know the Lord, and these people, they had experiential godliness of these ordinary church members. It is that experience of godliness that makes us to know that that's a real child of God, that's a real daughter of God, that's a real son of God. Look at Titus chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 11. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. Experiential godliness in ordinary church members. Titus chapter 2, reading from verse 11, it says, for the grace that of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness. If you are really born again, if you are saved, you'll be separated from the world. If you are saved, you will be a person that is set apart unto the Lord, and you will deny ungodliness. And then it says some worldly laws, that's in verse 12, that is the lusts of the world, the desires of the world, the attractions of the flesh, all that it will save you from. And then it says we should live soberly and righteously and godly. Where? I said where? in this present world, in this present life, we live that godly life. You see, you not say, well, you know, in my place of work, the temptation is so great. In my community, the challenges are so high. You need to come to a local government. Our province, the challenge is so great that I doubt if anybody can live the Christian life. If I were living in the city, if I were living in another place, maybe it would be easy for me. Well, you become born again, you are saved and you are sanctified and separated, and you are steadfast as part of the church. We read it. We have read about in the Acts of the Apostles, and you are submissive, you are sacrificial, you are sharing, you are sanctified. It is going to be clear in your life that there is godliness. It says in verse 14, who gave himself for us, that he might deliver us and redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. That's what he's telling us, that the experience we have, the experience of real godliness. Acts of the Apostles, I'm reading from chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, we're looking at verse 32. Acts chapter 4, verse 32. And the multitude of them that believe were of one heart. You see that? Those are real believers. Those are real believers. Not that after we preach the word of God here, some will stand in one corner there, another corner there. Did you accept that? Don't mind him. That's the way he talks. In fact, tomorrow when we come, we're going to demonstrate to him that, you know, we don't accept. Watch me. What when we get there tomorrow morning? They're just a counterfeit. The people that are real children of God, when we hear the word of God, it lacerates, it kind of cuts, it's offense in our hearts, and we've got on our knees. In reality, we say, oh Lord, I did that in ignorance. I'll never do that again in my life. I just want to remain on the altar, saved and sanctified and submissive and sacrificial. I lay everything upon the altar. There'll be something in your heart that wants to bear the word of God. There'll be something crying out within you, oh Lord, make me more like you. Oh, to be like thee, my Redeemer, my Savior. I just want the image of Christ stand deep on my heart. Well, you're a real child of God. It says over here that the multitude, there are not just 2 or 3 or 10 or 20 or 100 or 500. These were thousands of people. I said the multitude of them that believed, they were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but he had all things common. If you're a real child of, and a real minister of God, if you know you brought some of your people here, and we see that those people are carnal, those people are fleshly, and those people are incorrigible, and those people don't have the grace of God in them. If you're a real minister, a real overseer, you'll not call them behind and say, hey, this is Lagos, that's headquarters, I know, I'm sure of you, you are my members. They are your members, they are not the members of the invisible church. Encourage them in sin, encourage them in evil. So just you know, pretend as if you're, when we get to our place, all the liberty you want, all the this one that you want, don't mind, we're here now only for 1 week. Just try and control yourself. When we get back home, those are not Christians. And a minister like that, that to deceive his people and say, just pretend while you are here and don't have the real sin and don't tell them to repent, that's not real Christianity. But real Christianity is a thing that says we're wrong. That cannot be right. If we're real children of God, sin and iniquity and defilement, everything must get away from our lives. Now I've been telling you, at home, now you came over here and you reveal who you are really. Let's pray together. We're going to spend the night to pray, and that thing that is kicking in inside you, that is not submitting to the will and the word of God, we're going to get it out before the dawn, before the following morning. Those are the people that are real ministers of the gospel, and you're going to raise up ordinary members of the church that will have real power, real authority. I pray that we'll be ministers like that in Jesus' name, and we too will be members like that in Jesus' name. There'll be a change, a transformation in our lives. Look at the members of the Testament church in 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 4. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. And you know that he was manifested to take what? To do what? To take away our sins. To take away our sins. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. That's what you came to do. He'll call his name Jesus because he shall save his people from their sins. We're not here for religion. It is the real salvation of the Lord. And these people, they have experiential godliness. That when he came to Christ and Christ took hold of them and touched their heart and touched their spirit and touched their flesh and touched every part of them, it says he took their sins away. He was manifested that he might take away our sins. And in him is no sin. Look at verse 6. Whoever sinned and whoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whoever abideth in him sinneth not. It's not that, you know, I'm excusing this, you know. My father used to be of that, you know. My father used to follow after this. When I was growing up, I saw him. He had this woman and that woman. And because I think I'm born again now, I think it's because I got it from my father. When you are really born again, you are born again. And all that adultery, fornication, uncleanness, he'll take away from your life in Jesus' name. And then some people say, you know, I need to, this in confidence between you and I, don't tell anybody, but you know, this money matter, anytime I see money like this, it turns my head. And I've been thinking about it. I pray, I seek the face of the Lord, but money will not leave me alone. And I'm telling you, this between you and I, don't tell anybody. If I see the money, even if it belongs to anybody, I just take it and I'm so clever. In fact, it is the kind of gift I have. That's a hellish gift. It will drive you to hell. Give me a good amen. You know, but when I take that thing, then I realize, I look at my father, I said, Daddy was like that. Uncle was like that. Cousin was like that. I say that's my problem. You're not born again. If you're born again, all that thing that was in Daddy, all that thing in cousin, all that thing in uncle, everything will vanish away because it says, he that abideth in him sinneth not. You will not sin. I said, you will not sin. It says covetousness is idolatry because you make money your idol and you make all those things your idol. And when this experiential godliness comes to your life, there'll be a mighty change. It is those members of the church that have this transformation of life and then they're abiding in Christ and they sing not. Those are the people, a woman over there. And you say, I used to know my mommy. And my mommy, you know, I used to see the man that when daddy was not at home. And because that's the way mommy live, I'm born again, but this is the only challenge I have, that like mommy also I am, you know, I cannot stay with my husband. If you're not born again, if you are born again, all that will leave your life. You will understand that when a person becomes born again, all things have become new. How do you say you're born again and then there's a secret adultery and secret fornication and uncleanness in your life, and then you're attributing it to a kind of a, you know, it's in our genes. It's in our makeup. It's in our constitution. It breaks the yoke of cancer sin. And it sets the captive free. It will set you free if you're not free yet in Jesus' name. Look at the word of God in verse 7. Their little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous. Even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin, tell me the rest. Tell me out loud. Tell me out loud. I want you to read that verse this way. If I commit sin, I am of the devil. If I'm living in sin, I'm of the devil. If you're of the devil, how can you get to heaven? He that committeth sins of the devil. But it says over here, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, for this reason, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's the power of Calvary. That's the power of Christ and the power of the cross in our lives. When you come to Christ and you are washed in the blood of the Lamb, every small sin, every great sin, every secret sin, every public sin, every common sin, every unusual sin, everything, the power of the blood of Jesus will take it away. He'll take it away, your life, in Jesus' name. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin. You will not sin. I said you will not sin. It is the experiential godliness of ordinary members of the church. It says he cannot sin because he is born of God. In this, the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Then it says, whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. I pray that experiential godliness, the Lord will give it to you, give it to me, give it to every one of us in Jesus' name. We're looking at Romans chapter 6. I'm reading there from verse 1. Romans chapter 6. We're looking at verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? What's the answer? God forbid. Shall we continue in sin so that grace will abound? Because of the grace of God, the love of God, the mercy of God, shall we then continue in sin? Says God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? It says when we come to Christ, here is how experiential godliness takes place in the life of the ordinary members of the church. And it says, since we are born again, now we are dead to sin, how shall we live any longer in them? Look at verse 10. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, and that henceforth we should not serve sin. We'll not serve sin anymore in Jesus' name. That there's a total break, a total demarcation between you and the sins of the past. Verse 7, it says, and he that is dead is free from sin. Verse 11, likewise reckon also ye yourself dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Look at verse 12, it says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the laws thereof. Look at verse 16, it says, know ye not that to whomsoever, to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, is servants ye are, to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart, not from the head, not from the mind, ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine, that which was delivered unto you. Read verse 18, all of us, we are going to read verse 18 together, won't you go? Read that once again. For the last time. Being then made free from sin, he became the servants of righteousness. Look at verse 22, it says, but now, being made free from sin and become servants of God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. And that's what the Lord does for the people that really come to know the Lord. A change has taken place, a mighty change has taken place in their life. And the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, we call his name Jesus, because he shall save, he shall deliver, he shall rescue, he shall take his people away from their sins and take their sins away from them. That becomes a reality in your life. I pray that if it's not a reality yet, it will become a reality in your life in Jesus' name. Point number 2, excelling grace of ordinary church members. Excelling grace. The reason why those early church members, ordinary people, they were and then they did extraordinary things is because there was grace in their lives. Excelling grace. Grace that goes beyond the ordinary. And the supernatural power of God came along with that grace in their lives. And then they were able to have a change, a transformation, a turning around. Excelling grace of ordinary church members. I'm coming back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 33. It says, and when they had preached, the place was shaking where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. You see, those were members of the church, not just the apostles. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they were just told, and they spake the word of God with boldness. And that's verse 31. In verse 33 now, it says, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace, and great grace, and great grace, and great grace was upon them all. That excelling grace of God, that's what did that in their lives. In fact, we're told in Acts of the Apostles chapter 11. Acts chapter 11, I'm looking at verse 23. It says, so when he came and had seen the grace of God, he could see it by the fruit. I cannot see the wind, but I can see the effect of the wind as it blows the trees here and there. You cannot see the grace ordinarily, but when you see the righteousness, and the godliness and the experience and the lifestyle and the character and the attitude of the people and their submission and the obedience to the word of God. He said, there's grace there. There's grace there. And we're told that when these men of God, when they came to this place, they saw the grace of God and they were glad. And then it says, and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart, they will cleave and remain abide in the Lord. It tells us then that when that grace of God is there, people can see that, people can sense that, and people can see the evidence of the grace of God in our lives. Because you're not frivolous anymore, you're not careless anymore, you're not carefree anymore, and you're not flippant anymore, you're not superficial anymore, you're not carnal anymore, you're not fleshly anymore, you're not just a person that says, well, whatever I like, I do. If they like it, okay. If they don't like it, all right. You're bound by the word of God. I'm a child of God. A change has come upon my life, and the grace of God in me has made a change, has made a difference. And I pray that that grace, will be able to see that grace in every one of our lives, in Jesus' name. I said, in Jesus' name. I'm looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 1. We then, as workers together with him, beseech you that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. Receive not the grace of God in vain. If the grace of God is there, let it produce the godliness and the righteousness. Let it produce the sincerity and the single-mindedness. Let it produce the transparency of life, that anywhere you are, we can trust you. Anywhere you are, where you can be dependent, you are trustworthy. We say, no, he cannot do that. No, he will not do that. No, she will not do that. No, she cannot do that. Because we know she has received the grace of God, and she has not received that grace of God in vain. Look at verse 3. Giving none offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed. It's even talking about ordinary members, and not about the ministers of the gospel, the preachers of the gospel, that you will not do anything that will be an offense to the ministry of the word of God, that when we're preaching somewhere, they'll say, go and preach to so-and-so, is your member. Go and preach to so-and-so, is one of your pastors. Go and preach to so-and-so, is one of your key leaders over there. And we know what he does in our community over here. When he comes to church, they say, oh, they praise the Lord, hallelujah, God is good, and all the time God is good. But when he comes to the community, we know what he does. He's telling us that when we're real Christians, abiding Christians, he says, giving no offense in anything, in your place of work. You're not giving offense anything in the community. You're not giving offense in anything in the church, in the local church. Your local pastor is not afraid of you. And your local pastor is not saying, I cannot talk about that because that's touching so-and-so. I cannot go that direction because that's touching so-and-so. And then we're afraid to preach the truth because of you. You're not giving offense in anything because you abide in the word of God. And you're submissive to the word of God as your delight. It's your joy that the word of God is being preached. And it says, but in all things, approving yourself, approving ourselves as the ministers of God. Then it says, in much patience. And then in affliction, and in necessities, and in distresses. Then in strifes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings. And then it says, by pureness, by knowledge, by long suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, and by love, unpretending, unfeigned. It says, by the word of truth, no lying, no deception, no craftiness, no kind of, oh, this one is a political lie, this one is professional lie, this one is just a lie to cover up myself, this one is to save my face, this one is a white lie, this won't hurt anybody, this one is just to protect me, this one won't hurt him. I need to tell him this lie, I need to tell her this lie, because that will keep our marriage. You know, as a husband, you think I can tell that lady everything I'm doing and all the ladies I have contact with, you think I'm going to, that will disturb my marriage. And to preserve my marriage, whatever deal I have with any woman, whatever kind of secret discussion and secret plans, or whatever it is I have with any woman, you think I can tell that woman, it's going to break her heart. By the way, you know, she has high blood pressure. That's the reason why I don't want her to have heart attack. And if you don't want her to have heart attack, why are you continuing that kind of illicit, illegal, or scriptural relationship? I cannot tell her because they talk about this. I want to make restitution. And I want to be very sincere with her, but if I do that, it will kill her. You are a liar, you are protecting yourself. You are ashamed of yourself that you cannot tell her what you did, what you have done. And yet you are not going to quit. You're not leaving. Then you're pretending you are a member of the church. You are not a member of this church. You're just a carnal person that is pretending you are part of us. And one of these days, the Lord will expunge you and expel you and expose you. He'll do that in Jesus' name. And that day you'll be so ashamed. At that time, you think your wife is going to have a heart attack if you call her privately in the room and say, "Well, I've been foolish, I've been careless, I've done things. In fact, if you forgive me, it will be the grace of God in your life." I say, "Talk now. What do you mean? I'm just saying that, you know, I've done some foolish things that I don't think you even have. You cannot imagine how I've been unfaithful. Tell me what is it?" And then you get on your knees and tears in your eyes. You say, "I failed God. I failed you. I failed everyone." And he says, "I'll forgive you, my dear. Just tell me what you've done." And then you're weeping, you're sobbing. You don't even know how to say what you're going to say. And the woman has forgiven you before you even say anything. Then you open your mouth. Is that why you want to kill yourself? All right, I forgive you. And then, but make sure that there's total, genuine repentance and restoration, that you don't do that anymore. And write to all those ladies, contact them and say, "No more, I'm a married man now." That's Christianity. But you know, if you wait until God will expose you, your wife will know eventually. If she doesn't know it over here, when we get to the pearly gates, and then, you know, you're moving, you're walking in there, and then the other people, your wife is in, and your wife is, come in. And then when you want to come in, they shut the door. If your wife doesn't know now, she will know at that time. Then you'll be bad. Sin your life. Get rid of you, not be able to get, and then they monitor, they move you to go to that other side. She will know eventually. What are you talking about? I don't want her to. She will know. But it's better she knows now. You clean your life and clean everything up and say, "Lord, I want to serve you from now on to the rest of my life. From today, I want to have this glorious future that is holy, that is without blemish." And those are the people that are yet, they have the grace of God in their lives, and they, because of the grace of God, they said, "Nothing in my cupboard, no skeleton in my cupboard anymore. Everything is free." And I pray that from today, God will do that for us in Jesus' name. "Well, but if I do that, they will stop me preaching." Why don't you stop yourself? Are you qualified preaching? What, adultery there? Fornication there? Are you qualified preaching? Are you holding on to preaching? Holding on to ministry? Holding on to this, holding on to that. Because if I confess, this is what, of course, even before we stop, you ought to stop yourself. How can a leper be bringing the water of life unto other people? A sinner trying to convert other sinners. It doesn't happen. That's why many people are fruitless in their ministries. But when you come out clean and everything is all right, then after some time, say, God gives the grace and the chance again, then you will preach. Even if you don't preach till you die, getting to heaven is more than just preaching. But the hypocrites, eventually go to hell. That's why Paul the apostle said, "I keep my body under, so that after I preach to other people, I do not become what? A castaway." I pray you'll not be a castaway in Jesus' name. That's why it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 14, "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? What concord, what communion has light with darkness? And what concord has Christ with rebellion? And what part has he that believeth with an infidel? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the temple of God, of the living God, as God has said, 'I will dwell in them and walk in them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them, and be separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty.'" That's the grace of God. I pray that that grace will be relevant, will be visible in your life in Jesus' name. I thought you'd say good amen. Hebrews chapter 2, Hebrews chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 9 there. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, excelling grace of ordinary church members. Ordinary church members, they want no title at all, but then they had this grace of God, excelling grace, that made them to excel. and they were totally different from the sinners in their community. Everybody could see that that fellow has the grace of God and has nothing to hide. He lives a life in the open. His light is shining, and the righteousness of the Lord is visible in his life and in her life. And all the righteousness and all the iniquity and all the sin, everything has totally gone away, and the righteousness of the Lord and the purity that comes as a result of the cleansing of the blood of the Lamb, as a result of the changing, as a result of the transformation, that purity has become so real. Everybody can tell that this has happened to that woman, this has happened to that man. And if that has happened unto you, the grace of God has brought it forth, then we'll be able to tell. He lives in a community, he lives on a street. We know that man, we know that woman. And it's not just the external thing, right through, inner life. He can see through because the grace of God is there. And the Lord will not be ashamed to say, he is my child. The Lord will not be ashamed to say, I've touched him, I saved him, I sanctified him, and I brought him unto myself. Hebrews chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death. By the grace of God, we're talking about the grace of God, excelling grace that comes into our life. By the grace of God, should taste death for every man. Then you say, for it became him, for whom all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory. It's by that grace that brings us to glory. There's the grace of God in your life, there's the godliness that comes to your life, and then with the combination of that grace and the godliness, you are brought into glory. And then it says that he becomes the captain of our salvation, perfected through sufferings, for both he that sanctifies and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them what? Brethren. They're saved, brethren. They're separated, brethren. They're sanctified, brethren. They're submissive to the word of God, they're brethren. They're sacrificial in their giving, it says, they're brethren. And they're single-minded, following after the Lord and the Lord alone, all the days of their lives. That's why he now calls them brethren. I pray that grace of God will make you stable in the Lord in Jesus' name. And you'll not turn the grace of God to another thing. The grace of God will keep that purity, that righteousness, that holiness in our lives in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're looking at chapter 12 of Hebrews. I'm reading from verse 14 and verse 15. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. It says, follow peace with all men. Is that possible? I said, is that possible? Well, that means that there will be nothing in your heart looking for a fight. There will be nothing in your heart looking for conflict. There will be nothing in your heart, just whenever everything is peaceful, everything is all right, everything is calm, no storm, no conflict. They just say, it's too peaceful, it's too quiet. Somebody should raise up some dust here. There will be nothing like that in your heart. When you're really combating, you're a real child of God. Looks like, you know, the Congress has been going fine. And there's a man has the liberty to say everything he wants to say. And the other just wants to read the whole Bible. Looks like he has too much peace. He doesn't know what to do with that peace. And then, let me do something so that I can rock the boat. When you're a real child of God, you don't do that. You're not peace. You're a peacemaker. Because the Prince of Peace is dwelling in your heart. And you're not imagining and brainstorming, what can we do to scatter everything? You don't want to scatter, you want to gather together. And if you're a real child of God, here is the commission, here is the commandment. It says, follow peace with all men. We'll do that in Jesus' name. If there's somebody there that doesn't want peace, doesn't want to follow peace with the pastor, follow peace with the workers, follow peace with the rest of us who are here, and they just want to make trouble, I think God can give us grace to just overlook them. Now the Judas discovered that, you know, just somebody brought in, and he wants to make some gain out of us. Wants to be able to, if I do this and do that and, you know, scatter and cause trouble, I think I'll be able to, you know, have my desires met. I'll be able to prove to them that, you know, they say they are sanctified. I can make them angry. I can confuse them. I can do this to them to show that the blood of Jesus cannot sanctify. That's their goal, that's their goal. And you want to be able to just pat them aside and just push them aside and say they're looking for trouble. They don't want peace. They want to scatter the church of living God. They want to say Jesus is wrong. He's saying that I build my church upon the rock, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I can show them that Jesus is wrong. I can show them that that church, he says, is bigger, right? That the gates of hell, at least I represent that, I can rock them and destroy them and scatter them. Don't allow them to prove our Jesus wrong. They don't have love for Jesus, respect for Jesus. All they want to do is to say that Jesus cannot make the church united. All they want to say is that Jesus' blood cannot unite us and make us peaceful. But I want to say that Jesus is the Prince of Peace. I said Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And the people that do not love peace and don't want to follow peace with all men, all people in the church and all people in the community, we can overlook them and just neglect them. It's like a dog barking. And when that dog is barking, you know, you don't bark at the dog. Bark, you're not his dog, you're a child of God. Just look at the dog and just overlook them. And after they bark and bark and bark, and then they see that, you know, there's no other dog to bark at them back, then they keep quiet and then they wag their tails and run away. And I pray that as they run away, they'll never come back again. Follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. This holiness we're talking about is centrality of seeing the Lord, who will abide in your heel. Who will abide in that holy place? They that have clean hands and a pure heart, those who have not lifted up their heart unto vanity. Then he tells us, if us became, we are following through with the grace of God, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. That is the grace of God has come. You're looking diligently in your life. That excelling grace of God, the exceedingly great grace of the Lord, will be in your life, will abide and remain in your life in Jesus. And looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. I pray that nobody will be defiled through me and through you in Jesus' name. I said nobody will be defiled through me, through you in Jesus' name. So that as you are holy, you are an encouragement to other people to be holy as well. As you are peaceful, you are an encouragement to other people to be peaceful as well. Point number three now, extraordinary gifts of ordinary church members, extraordinary gifts of ordinary church members. Do you know that God has a gift for every one of us? I say God has a gift for every one of us. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and I'm looking at verse 7 here. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with that. The gifts of the Spirit, give it to every man. Not just every apostle, every prophet, every evangelist, every pastor, every teacher. It's given to every man to profit with that. I'm looking at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. Ephesians chapter 4, and we're looking at verse 7 there. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. But unto every one of us, what of that? Unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Give it to everyone. The gift of God, the gift of Christ, the gift of the Spirit. Give it to everyone. Extraordinary gifts of ordinary church members. I'm looking at Luke chapter 11 verse 13. The gift of the Holy Ghost for everyone. Everyone to ask. Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. Why don't you back up to verse 9. And I say unto you, ask, and shall be given you, seek, and you shall find, knock, and shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, ask me. I said, ask me. Everyone that asketh, receive it. And then he says, and he that seeketh, findeth, and to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. For if a son ask bread of any of you, that say, Father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him? Will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If he then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give who? The Holy Spirit to them that ask him. the Holy Spirit. We're talking about the gifts now. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. So you'll see what it says. He'll give the Holy Spirit to everyone that has came. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. God also bearing the witness and both of signs and wonders and diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. He gives them gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. You know that in the early church, that's what they had, every member of the church, not just the apostles, not just the prophets, not just the evangelists, not just the pastors, not just the teachers, not just the ministers and the officers of the church, every one of them. That's how we read in Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, I'm reading verse 1 and then verse 4. Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, verse 1 to start with, and Saul was consenting unto his death, unto the death of Stephen. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Only the apostles remained in Jerusalem. All the normal, ordinary members, they were scattered away, abroad, everywhere. Look at verse 4. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad, believers, ordinary believers, ordinary members of the church, they that were scattered abroad, they went everywhere. What were they doing? They were preaching the word. And were preaching with power, preaching with effectiveness. And there are many souls coming into the kingdom of God. Let me show you one of them and see extraordinary things that happen. Chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 26. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip. You see that? Philip was not an apostle, but just like a deacon. It was actually an ordinary member they chose to be able to distribute food. And the angel of the Lord spake unto him. I want you to look at that same chapter. We're looking at verse 29. Verse 29. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near and join thyself to this chariot. Go near. The Spirit spoke to him. An angel spoke to extraordinary experiences. Exploits. Look at verse 39. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found in Azotus, and there was no aeroplane that took him, there was no boat that took him. Just all of a sudden, the Spirit of God caught him and transported him to another city. Just an ordinary member of the church, not an apostle. If God can do that at that time, extraordinary gifts are still waiting for us in Jesus' name. I'm looking at Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 10. And there was a certain disciple, not an officer, a certain disciple, member of the church at Damascus, and named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I'm here, Lord. He saw a vision. He heard the voice of the ordinary member. Great exploits and great experiences, even though they were not great ministers in the church. I'm saying that if that happened to those ordinary members, it will happen to us too in Jesus' name. After all, we're not even ordinary members here. Are you not an overseer? Are you not a pastor? Are you not a leader? Are you not a worker? And he says, if it happened to us, it will happen to us. And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street, which is called Strange, and inquire in the house of Judas, the one for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayed. You see a lot of revelation in that verse 11. The Lord said unto him, Arise and go to the street. He mentioned the street. And then to the house of so and so of Judas. And then it's also said, there's one person there called Saul. He even told you what Saul was doing. Behold, he prayed. Can you see the revelation of God coming to just this man, Ananias, an ordinary member of the church? And if that begins to happen to us, that some of us who are here, you just push aside all those things you are thinking about that is hindering from moving forward, and they will say, by the grace of God, that Spirit of God, and the gift, extraordinary gift, as Ananias had, as all those scattered believers as they are, we're going to have it you, and we'll wait upon the Lord, and we'll allow that anointing, that unction to come upon us, something will begin to happen. I said something began to happen. And if every one of us here, as we go to have the extraordinary gifts of the Spirit of God, as it happened to Ananias here, who was not an apostle, what a great mighty revival there will be. And then when Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he has done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel. The Lord was even telling Ananias the future ministry of this man. So what a great revelation. Ordinary member, then he goes on to say, for I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Look at verse 17. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hand on him, said, brother Saul, even in his conversion, he knew the genuineness, the sincerity, and the life that this man now has, brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way. Saul did not tell him that Jesus appeared to him, but he knew by revelation. Look at all the gifts that this man had, Ananias, that he knew that the Lord appeared unto him in the way. He has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes, as it had been scales, it was healed of his blindness. By this, Ananias, the gift of healing was there, gift of revelation was there, and the vision was there, everything was there. For this ordinary believer, it happened to him, it will happen to you. Then it says, immediately, there fell from his eyes as it were, even scales, and it says, he received the sight forthwith and arose, and he was baptized. If that happened to them, it will happen to us. I said it will happen to us. If we ask, if we seek, if we know, if it's a desire of our heart that we already want to get the best during this Congress, it'll do something permanent in our lives in Jesus' name. And we're looking at Daniel. Before we pray, we're looking at Daniel. Daniel chapter 11. What the Lord is telling us, that even in this particular time, this difficult time in many countries of the world, this is what God will do to the people that know him. In Daniel chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 32. It says, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be corrupt by flatteries, but the people that do know their God shall be strong. And what will they do? They will do exploits. It can happen. I said it can happen. It will happen in Jesus' name. We're going to rise up before the Lord, and we're going to say, oh Lord, God want that. Ordinary members, they had extraordinary ministries. We're going to have that too in our own ministries, in our personal lives. We're going to have that in our local churches. We're going to have that in ministries the Lord has given unto us. But really begins with that exceeding grace of God. Why don't you just go to the Lord in prayer and say, oh Lord, I want grace that excels, grace that exceeds, grace that exceeds all the foolishness of the past, all the carelessness of the past, all the carnality of the past, and all the falling and rising of the past. Grace, grace that exceeds. You want the Lord to give that. You open your mouth and pray to the Lord and say, Lord, grace, 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 God's grace within and around. He can give us that grace, that exceeding grace, exceedingly great grace, and put that in our lives. Talk to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, do that for me, do that for me. Make sure that you are coming as a child of God. You are saved. You are submissive to the word of God. You are separated from all the permissions of in your mind, in your heart. You say, Lord, from today, a totally separated life. You are sanctified, not you are steadfast. You say, Lord, I'm going to follow you for the rest of my life. All the up and down, all the here and there. I'm going to stop all that and lay everything I've got upon the altar. Tell the Lord, it is when he does that in our lives, and now you are single-minded. You have only one focus, only one thing, and you are desiring just to please the Lord and to know the Lord, and to follow the way of the Lord for the rest of your life. And then you're soul winning, you're telling the Lord, I want to be able to win souls. I want to be able to give sacrificially my time, my skill, my ability, everything I've got. All the childishness I have, I throw that aside. All the carefree attitude I have, I throw that aside. All the frivolity I have, I throw that aside. I want the grace of God to be visible in my life. So in my inner life, outward life, in my interaction, in my fellowship, everything, I want that grace of God to really show to the people around that I went to the Mount of Transfiguration and the Lord has transformed my life. And then the experiential goodness, practical godliness that the Lord gives unto us, that you really see that by the grace of God, this practical godliness is there. This experiential godliness is there. Anymore you appear to be just a minister in the fellowship, a minister just in our church, then God begins to do great, mighty things in your life. You're telling the Lord, I need extraordinary gifts to you, the gifts of the Spirit of God, baptized in the Spirit, immersed in the Spirit, indwelt by the Spirit, enveloped by the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit of God. I want the gifts of the Spirit as well, the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the sending of spirits, the gift of faith, the gift of healing, the gift of miracles, and the prophecy and the tongues and the interpretation. Oh Lord, I need the gift so that I can do exploits for the Lord in this day and age and time in which I am. Extraordinary gifts for ordinary church members. The Lord has promised, if you seek the Lord, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run, they will not be weary, and they will walk, and they will not be. Seek the Lord, he has promised to answer. Say, God who answers prayer, the Lord will answer.